spectacular preview, and great work, as always, with Ken Burns. And I'm delighted to introduce our panel for tonight. First, in the middle is Anne Eleanor Roosevelt, who's president and CEO of Goodwill Industries of Northern New England, and joined Goodwill in 2011 from the Boeing Company in Chicago. Anne's careers encompassed leadership positions in philanthropy, public policy, politics, the arts, and higher education. She currently chairs the Roosevelt Institute. So thank you for coming from Maine. Daniel. Daniel J. White is the editor and associate producer for the Roosevelts and was responsible for the research and acquisition of archival footage. He is currently the post-production coordinator and assistant editor for Ken Burns' upcoming film, The Vietnam War. We were talking at dinner. That's going to be a remarkable program. So thank you for coming. Thank you. And finally, Pam Tubridy of Baucom. Is one of the three producers of the Roosevelts. She focused on historical research for film, for the film, and she has been an assistant to Ken Burns for, 16 years, as well as a coordinating producer for a number of Florentine productions. And previously she was a teacher, and she's currently working on a new film on country music. And we were talking about that at dinner, and it sounds like that's gonna be a remarkable program. So. I'm just going to start with a couple of questions. We have someone with a roving mic. We really want you to take the opportunity to ask our panelists questions. And if we have students in the audience, we really encourage you to get up some and ask your questions as well. Anne, if you don't mind, I'll lead with you with a question. What did the family learn about the film?
When did the family
What did the family learn about the film?
What do we think of the film, you mean? We're all very enthusiastic about it. We were not involved, as you could tell, in the making of the film, which I think is always the right decision. So for some of us, who, for instance, were born after FDR died, and I don't think any of us who survived knew Uncle Teddy. It's all a very individual experience to see what that is deep within us is actually reflected in the story that's told in these episodes.
And I understand that Ken showed the film to the entire family. So did they have
showed an excerpt like this at a family reunion last year.
And any special remembrances of your grandparents when you were a child?
Well, so I'm one who was born after my grandfather died, but I did know my grandmother, and I have special remembrances of her as a child would remember your grandmother. And from the time I was born, I'm named after her, and I get the cousin's prize for looking the most like her. I felt an identity with her, even though I'm one of 28 cousins.
Wow.
She was an extraordinary person in that there were always a lot of people around, but you still felt like she was accessible to you. She would, even to a child, she would still take the time to listen to me, even though there were adults waiting to grab her full attention as well.
Well, that's wonderful. Pam and Dan, why don't you talk a little bit about how the documentary filmmaking process? I mean, there's a tremendous amount of research and acquisition of footage and what have you. So take us through that.
Okay. Pam, do you want to start?
Yeah. So my role as a producer is one part of it is herding cats, but a great deal of it is doing research and sort of helping to pull things together to then hand it off to the editors who, in my book, really do create, at least initially, the film, working from an incredible script by Jeffrey Ward. Jeffrey is the writer of the film. He's also a polio himself, and you saw his interview, and when he was talking about Franklin Roosevelt coming down with polio, he was also talking about himself. And he's a very dignified man and doesn't speak much about himself. And was, you know, it was very moving. Dan and I were in that interview when he was being interviewed, and it was, we were overwhelmed. We were weeping in the back listening to him speak. So he wrote a beautiful script. I mean, Paul Barnes is the other, he's the lead producer. There are two producers along with Ken. Ken has to do so many other things these days, so he relies on his producers on the various films to do a lot of the home front work and also go out and do the work that's involved in gathering all of the ingredients to make the bread. So Paul and I in 2008 started to read about the Roosevelts. And I was a history major in college, but you know, like in anything you study in college, you know, there's a lot of information out there in the world and you have lots of classes, so you have some information, but I learned a tremendous amount by doing this research. And as we were reading, the thing that Paul and I were both struck with was, how in the world can Jeff ever make Eleanor Roosevelt in any way come up to these two incredibly dynamic men who were president, and just the fact that they were both presidents. And he absolutely more than made her. She is, the three of them are equals. I mean, you'll see it in the film if you have a chance to watch. She's just tremendous throughout. So he wrote a wonderful script. But you have the script, but you don't have it right away. So when you're starting a film, you have a certain amount of time in which to do this. And so Paul and I are reading. Susanna Steisel was an associate producer. She's starting the initial photo research. And we had a relatively tiny crew at Florentine Films because we started right when the recession hit. So people were wearing many hats. Susanna and I were the only two people that were dedicated just to gathering the ingredients for the film. The other guys did that and they also were editors. So Paul was a producer and an editor. And those are very involved, two very, very involved roles to play. So it was a lot of work, but it was very rewarding. So we're out, Danny spent a lot of time looking for footage online, going to archives. We all had help. There were 11 of us who worked on this project at Florentine Films, so lots of us were looking for photographs, lots of people were looking for footage. Paul and I were listening to a lot of music. So you had all these elements being researched while Jeff is writing the script. So people say, gee, did you, and also doing interviews. We had 18 interviews, 15 of them were with historians. And the other three, one was Dorothy Hyde, whom you saw tonight. The other were two people who were down in Warm Springs when Franklin Roosevelt was there, who now are in their 80s. So those other than that, we had historians. And a lot of people say, well, gee, how did you get so-and-so to say what you wanted him to say? And that is not the case. You pick people who are experts in whatever field your film is about. And these experts have knowledge in different areas. So some of the experts are Theodore Roosevelt experts. Some know a lot about Eleanor, some about all. And you ask them questions related to their books. And what happens is when you come back, you look at the entire interview, and then you do what's called selecting, which means you select out the most important, or what you think are the most important salient points that they bring up. And even throughout the process of the filmmaking, when we're putting the film together, you can add and subtract. So that's what happens all along. So everything is happening concurrently. You're doing all this research, you're doing these interviews. Paul and I, also with Dan, went out on the road, and first we scouted the five homes where the Roosevelts lived, as well as a home that Eleanor had lived in. The building you saw when she's holding her bicycle in front of that, that's an amazing place. It's in Tivoli, New York. It's an abandoned, it was the home of her grandmother, her maternal grandmother. And it's called Oak Terrace, and it's this haunted place. The people haven't lived in it in decades. And a lot of it is left as it was. There were some groups in there, they changed things around, but basically you could feel this lonely, beautiful child in that house. That was one of my favorite places actually to shoot. So we went to Warm Springs. We went to, which is where Franklin Roosevelt actually died and where he also was in the pools. We went to Theodore Roosevelt's birthplace, his home in Oyster Bay, Franklin Roosevelt's home in Hyde Park, and up in Campobello, and then, so there were six places that we first scouted to see what we wanted to shoot, and then we went back and did a number of shoots in those places. We have 18 and a half hours of interviews. We had 20 hours of live footage, and we probably, what did we say we used, Danny?
About four or five
of those hours are actually in the film. So there's a lot of material that you gather and then you don't use. And for the photographs, we always use the maple syrup analogy, which is the 40 to 1, because we had about 23,000 photographs and we used 2,200. So we give the editors lots of material from which to work. So we're doing all that while the script is being made, and then Danny will take it from there.
Sure. So, yes, I'm Dan White. I'm one of the cats that Pam herded, of course. One of my major roles was gathering the archival footage that you see in the program, of which we collected close to 200 hours and used about 3.5 hours. And almost all of that is high definition, going back to the original negative, if possible. And so another part of the process is, I guess I'd go into the post-production. Pam was talking a lot about the pre-production of the research and gathering all the materials together. That's just preliminary, and all of them reading and meshing out the story, the outline, and the writer writing. And then moving into the post-production, which is where the editing starts that Pam mentioned, where people sit alone in dark rooms trying to put all of the elements together according to the script, which is tyranny of choice because, as I mentioned, how many photographs, how much material, how much live footage there is, and to bring that down into 14 hours that makes sense and doesn't bore people, it takes some time. And we were lucky enough to have five years,
about
2 years for editing, but 5 years overall to hone down the story. Most documentarians don't have that luxury that we do under Ken. They usually have to turn around something in a year or less, which I'm sure that Peter and the folks at NHPTV can attest to. So we are able to put some great amount of time into our craft. And then once it gets to a certain point, after so many revisions in the script, so many revisions in the edit, and we finally come to a place where we think this is good to show, and that all the facts are right, we hope, then we ring the bell. We actually had a cowbell that we would ring every time we finished one of the episodes, and we would call it locked. And then we start getting all the materials together again to make it master, to make it as beautiful as you saw it here today, and as beautiful as you're gonna see it hopefully Sunday night at 8 p.m. on New Hampshire Public Television.
Yeah, and you should give you a little bit of context that where your studios are, where you're editing, is really an old farmhouse. And so
1840s,
and our board was fortunate to go out and have a tour last year. We were in the dining room or the parlor where all the editing was being done. So with all the period, lights and lamps and what have you there. One thing we're talking about dinner and that is how you select the voices. And you talked a little bit about, Pam, about some local people that
this happened to be a very tight script, as I said. Sometimes there are scripts that are 90 pages long for an episode, and for a two-hour episode, you need between 35 and 40 pages. So there's a lot of cutting that's involved. So as we're making the film, we need somebody to read the narration, because initially the writer is writing the narration, the story. Most of the talking you heard, that was Peter Coyote. For the first probably year and a half or so, that voice that the editors hear and everyone in the house hears is Ken's. So once we have a script that's at a place where we want to have Ken record, we have this little tiny booth in our editing house in Walpole. It looks like little egg crates along the wall. And he's in there and he reads. And so initially I think this film was It was probably maybe 16 hours, maybe a little bit longer. So he did all this reading probably over 3 days. I mean, he's brilliant. But you also need those first-person voices. So as you probably noticed, we didn't have Eleanor read, although it sure sounded like her, and we had Meryl Streep. So Meryl Streep is the voice of Eleanor Roosevelt. Paul Giamatti is the voice of Theodore Roosevelt. And there are only a few examples of Theodore Roosevelt's voice extent that we know of. We always are horrified by when this thing is over, we're going to find somebody who found these cylinders that have, oh, wait, I have these in my garage. If anybody finds the photograph of Eleanor, Franklin, and Theodore together, you're going to get a big prize.
Or footage,
because those we could not find. But anyway, so we had, so Ken reads that narration, and then we have local people in town. Some of them have been in local plays. Two teachers, one from Conville High School, one from Fall Mountain. We had a young girl for the film on World War II who was 12 at the time. They had to have someone read these diaries of a young girl, Sasha, who was over in the concentration camp, or I don't know if they called it a concentration camp, in Philippines. And she read, and then we have all kinds of other people. The voice that you heard tonight of the German assassin is the chocolatier at Burdick's chocolate shop in Walpole. So what we do is we hire local folks. We don't hire them. They just come in gratis. They're very happy to do it. And some of them actually get in the film. And the way that the structure of payment works with SAG for public television, you're allowed to use a non-SAG member once. And so those folks are in there once. And so, for example, this the chocolatier, there was an Italian professor from Dartmouth. And there's another young man who was an actor, actually was a SAG member from Peterborough. They're all in this film. And they will make as much money as Meryl Streep when they have residuals come out. And so the young woman who did the reading for us, she made some money off of that. She was 12 years old, and she's about 21 now. So we do have local folks, but most of the time, once we're done, we then pick a narrator. And many of our films, we had David McCullough actually early on. We've had Ossie Davis. We've had Keith David in a number of our films. And in the last number of few films, we've had Peter Coyote, who was brilliant. Ken can read the script, you know, first time out. We maybe do a couple of takes certain parts. Just with Peter, to have someone come in out from the outside who you send the script to and he doesn't read it because he wants to do it cold. He's in the studio and he has a pencil in his hand and he's conducting himself. I mean, it's just amazing to watch. And his inflection, and I've tried it because they've had us try it sometimes at work. Yeah. It is not easy. It is not an easy thing to do. So anyway, that's what we do, and we get a lot of actors from Hollywood. And I've been actually setting up the voices myself for about 15 years. And initially, it was like pulling teeth. You know, you'd have to go through 7 or 8 agents to get to the final agent who could get you someone. Now people actually call us and ask if they can be in the film. So it's actually much easier to do. But people come in and they're lovely. I mean, we've worked in New York and Los Angeles and Seattle. Most of the time it's done in New York, but the folks are just great to work with. And they do a wonderful job.
Good. Questions from the floor? Yes, we have a mic over here.
Thank you. Sorry. This is less of a question and more of a comment. Actually, I'm a student here at St. Anselm College, and as part of our humanities program, we have portraits of human greatness. And last semester, our final project was to pick another portrait of human greatness that hadn't been featured in the entire curriculum. And so a group of us chose Eleanor Roosevelt, and it was very interesting to see that some of the people that you had on were sources that I had used in my paper. But it was also just very interesting because she's such a multifaceted person, just to see other, more of a holistic view of her as a person. So thank you for making this and then putting it on here.
Good. Could you talk a bit about your grandmother's person, mm-hmm. being multifaceted? I recall as a young kid just hearing about her and just how amazing she was from the standpoint of all her engagement and concern.
Well, and I think that's what I, you know, remember most about her was just how engaged she was with everything. And she did, she seemed to do everything. I mean, she loved being in her garden, and she also, you know, debated with Nikita Khrushchev. I mean, she was, and with equal passion. She was really a remarkable person, and I knew that as a child. I knew that she was somehow special, but she still felt like she was just, you know, mine. And as I've gotten, you know, gone through my life, I've realized that a lot of people felt that she was theirs. And I realized that I needed to accept that I shared my grandmother with a lot of people who grew up with her, but also a lot like you, who never had, you know, her life was not part of your experience, but still her writings and the story, her life story, is still speaks to us.
Other questions? Back here.
I was just wondering, what do you think the political legacy is of really all three, but especially FDR and Eleanor Roosevelt, for people of my generation especially, but in general? Because, I mean, I'm aware of, you know, the, let's say the legend of it, and I'm just wondering what you think of, like, after having made this film especially, what do you think that legacy is, you know, as a model, as an inspiration, as anything, really?
I'd be happy to answer that, because I think that, I hope that everyone here watches the whole film. If you can't watch it every night next week, then tape it and watch it, because it is an extraordinary message. That it is the story of our political legacy. It's a portrait of leadership in a democracy that is extraordinarily important right now. And I think what it tells us is that, as my grandfather said, government is ourselves. And if we demand it, we can have this kind of leadership, but we have to demand it. There is a, and I think that all three of them, that's what's so great about this series, is that you see, you know, one was a Republican and two were Democrats, and they, but it is a continuum of commitment to democracy, to human rights, to doing the right thing with courage, to not caring about differences as much as we care about our commonalities. And that is a hope that I think we can all have, that there we can still right this ship and make democracy work for ourselves and as a beacon for the world. I chair, as you mentioned, the Roosevelt Institute. We have a student organization. We have 12,000 college students around the country who engage in policy and political activity because they're inspired by the legacy of Franklin, Eleanor, and Theodore Roosevelt. And if it speaks to contemporary students like yourselves, there's hope for us all.
Yes, sir.
you mentioned that you did this as a family reunion. You got to screen this film, and that you really shouldn't have contributed the film as well. I'm curious how many arguments it created at the reunion in your interpretation versus theirs.
I don't think there were any arguments with her.
Oh, no. There were about 163 Roosevelts, and if you're related to Franklin and Eleanor, you're also related to Theodore. If you're just a Theodore, you're not. So there was one little corner. They were all, everyone was absolutely intermingling. And as Dan said, I've never had so much fun at someone else's family reunion. And then it was, well, that's because it's not your own. It was remarkable, and people were just lovely. And as far as we know, and I don't think they were pretending, they really loved what they saw.
And I think that's really true. I think that there might be, there might be a discussion on some of the historians' interpretations. You know, mm-hmm. One or the other of us might feel differently than one or the other of the historians. But the whole thing, we are quite unanimous. And I have to correct myself, though, when I said that the family didn't have anything to do with this film, because Ken told me Monday night
that. All right.
That. He's related to us.
1/5,000th
of a... eighth cousin. Eighth cousin. Yeah. That's amazing.
That's right. Well, and we also, it is, you know, I've read some memoirs of people, and they've put their lives out for you to read. Or you go on Facebook, and I always feel like you're a little... I'm not on Facebook, but every now and then I'll sneak in to see our sons. And you feel like a voyeur, and then you say, wait a minute, they chose to do this, but their family did not choose to do this. We chose to do it. So when we went down there, it was a little nerve-wracking just to, you know, here you are, you're presenting to the people who are related to these remarkable folks, and hopefully when they all get to see all of it, they'll be as pleased. Also, from Theodore's side, we had a young man actually in our office. His stepdad is a great grandson, I believe, of Theodore, and he was so. Both Anne and Mark were at got to see the entire film. So we feel like both sides saw and both sides liked. At least a representative. So that was a good thing.
Yes, in the back here.
I just have a curiosity about money. Hollywood films, you always hear about the box office and how many millions they take in. What finances all the work that you do?
That's a great question. Yeah, our budgets are about a week of craft services for a Hollywood film. we get about 36% from viewers like you through PBS and CPB. We get about 22% from a corporate funder, which is now Bank of America, and has been for a number of years. Before that, it was General Motors. And then another 20, you know, and I don't have my numbers. Oh, I do have them here, but I don't want to cheat. But anyway, through nonprofit organization, Arthur Vining Davis, the Pew Charitable Trust, lots of times. Depending on the film, we'll have, for example, with the Mark Twain film, we had people, the state of Connecticut, I think some from Missouri gave money. So sometimes states will contribute. So we get them from lots of sources. Ken has to do a lot of work on fundraising. I mean, he is the most well-known, or just about the most well-known documentarian in the country, but he has to work very hard to get the funding for what we do. So. We're very grateful for PBS and for viewers like you who support what we do, but our budgets are, pretty small for what we do. And we have actually a pretty small staff. I mean, our editing studio is 18 people. So those editors are editing all of our films. So as one film is going out, another one is coming in. And we always work on different projects at the same time. They're in all different, like this film will come out on Sunday. Danny's in the heat of a very complicated and harrowing film on Vietnam. So those editors are on that right now. And then we have another crew that's working on a film on Jackie Robinson. And I, as a year ago, I've been working on both these films. I'm helping out the producers Dayton Duncan and Julie Dunphy on a film on country music. So we always have something in the hopper in various stages, all of which require funding. And now there is a group called Better Angel Society, which is a nonprofit group that's been established. It's separate from Florentine, but they have been helping to fund. And those are individual donors, because the landscape is tough. Anybody who is in any kind of public service or nonprofit, it's very hard to get funding these days.
Yeah, and we have some New Hampshire Better Angels donors.
Yes, we do. Yes. Gripponies.
Yeah. The Gripponies are one.
Yes, yeah.
There was another question here on, right here.
I think you mentioned that you started doing the film around 2008, is that
yes,
correct?
Yes, the fall of 2008 we started reading.
So of course, 2008 is the economic meltdown.
That's right.
And I am curious if that had anything to do with the decision, like how did you choose to tell this story? There are so many stories to tell, and yet the timing of 2008, and when you look at the story and you're hearing the story of the Depression, it just seems like, oh my God, you had to make this story now.
Well, we in some ways we wished we'd had it at 2012, although things worked out, but depending on your politics. But this story, Ken and Jeff have wanted to make this film for a long time.
Okay.
Jeff's obvious, and he's written two remarkable books about Franklin Roosevelt that go up to his governorship of New York State. Never wrote the third book of the trilogy, but this is the third book right here. But this was a long time coming. They'd wanted to do this for a long time. So this was in the hopper probably, I mean, for a long time, but I would say by 2005 or so, they were starting to plan. We always plan way ahead. I mean, okay. We have, the country music film isn't gonna come out until 2018 or 19. We have a film in Hemingway that's not gonna come out until 19 or 20, depending on what happens. Sometimes you get backed up with our editing. So things are planned way ahead. It just happened that the recession
hit. I just wanted to make a comment. The other comment that I thought was so powerful, just from these excerpts, was the license to make mistakes.
Mm-hmm.
That is, I think, the most, that jumped out at me more than anything else at a time when we are so incapable of doing anything. The power and the meaning of this story coming out, especially now with the dysfunctional Congress, is the idea that you have to try anything. And it's okay to make a mistake, but you have to keep trying. Yeah. So I guess thank you.
Thank you. You're welcome. Yeah, it's, last night, the other night, we went to something at Franklin Pierce College, and people asked us, who did we like the best or whatever. I mean, the thing that, certainly for the two of us, for Dan and I, and I think for a lot of the crew, is the learning that took place while we were making this film, and the humanity of these three people, and the suffering that they each had, and how they still managed to, rise above themselves and care for the whole. And also their flaws, like we all have. And as Dan has a favorite quote, which he can tell from Eleanor Roosevelt, but their personal flaws and their personal gifts, and as, said in this portion that you saw tonight, that he was a consummate politician and she was not, but she had such passion. And, it's hard when you're a politician, and I'm not one, but you have to compromise. And it's difficult for people to realize how difficult that is, because you want, one side or the other. And really, the only way we get things done, in a lot of ways, I mean, if you do watch the whole film, which we hope you do, you'll see lots of compromise going on. But what was your favorite quote from Eleanor?
No one is all good or all bad.
Right. It's
very simple, but just automatically a forgiving and, understanding thing to say about anyone. I was thinking about when we were watching this that my wife Jamie would think that I'm more like Theodore, but I would like to be more like Eleanor. A little bullheaded sometimes.
Can you talk a little bit about Ken as a director, and what are some of his greatest strengths as a filmmaker?
I think, besides being one of the greatest storytellers, and I'm not just talking about a storyteller in making films, but he can walk into a room and tell an incredible story about just this trip anywhere. But as a boss, as a director, that he can stand back and trust his staff, you know, that is well trained by very experienced people to go ahead and do these things and then come in once in a while and say, okay, well, actually, this has to go here, this, and we're all like, of course, how did we not see that? No, but he has this recipe of how to make a film and how to tell a story, and then there's trained, experienced editors who help convey that and tell it visually and with music and sound effects and all the other elements that you saw in here and heard in here, to be able to represent that story that Ken wants to tell, and then he directs it, you know, and says, if we just, you know, if there was a still that could do this, you know, and when he says it, it just seems so obvious. And in fact, in the intro, you see FDR, and it's like, God, it just, every time I see it, it makes my heartbeat, where he's at Mount Rushmore, and that's actually in episode 5. But Ken was just, it's like, that, you know, that needs to go in the intro. And the intro is one of the hardest things to cut in a film, because you're trying to bring everyone in and tell a little bit about what the rest of the 14 hours is about. And he just brought that little piece in, and it's one of the things that sticks out most to me now in the introduction, is FDR saying 10,000 years from now, you know.
Pam? Thoughts? You've worked very closely with Ken for these many years.
Well, he's brilliant, and that's the first thing. So, but besides that, as Dan said, he does allow, I mean, as I was talking about all those elements being gathered, he trusts that those in this film, there were three main editors and three assistants, that they have a blank screen. They get that script, and the first day they sit down, and they have all this material, and they have to make these choices, and he trusts that they're going to do it, and they do. And so they'll put this film together, and then people, the producers come in, Ken comes in, the writer, sometimes we have people from the outside, and we do this over and over. This film was probably 10 what we call screenings, where we all sit around, watch the entire film, comment on the entire film, give him feedback. We have people from the outside, and we take notes on everything that people say. We don't always implement, but we listen, and he listens. In the end, he's the one that makes the decision. But it really is, you know, a team of people. And it really is a team of people who, as I said, there were 11 of us who initially put this together. Then we added 2 more of our crew to help with the sound cutting. But then we have hundreds of people on the outside who have helped gather photographs, gather footage at all the archives, all the finishing houses. Most of the finishing work is done in New York. And you have people down there who are colorists and sound people, and all the crew that goes out and shoots with us, the cameramen and the soundmen. So there's so many people that go into making these films. But ultimately, the responsibility for the fundraising, the responsibility for what we're going to do, the responsibility for how this thing, you know, ends up is on Ken. And, you know, as you may have seen some press, I mean, he's out now on the road and has been for months promoting this film. Tomorrow night we're doing something else. It'll be 3 nights this week. We're tired. And to think that he does this, you know, week after week. But he enjoys it. He's energized by it, and he's really good at it. He's a very good speaker. So he's a great speaker, but he also trusts, as Danny said, he has, you know, gotten to the point in his career, and it's been a long time coming. He's got a great team of people in New York who are working on Vietnam. He's got a great team with Dayton working on country music. His son-in-law and daughter are working on Jackie Robinson, so he trusts people, which is huge, to be allowed to let people, you know, and sometimes make mistakes, and just like the Roosevelts, and we keep moving on.
Yeah, he's a remarkable individual. I had the pleasure of testifying with him before Senate committee with Senator McCain, and he's just so eloquent in weaving and telling the story about why public television. And then they handed it to me, and I went, So we have time for a couple more questions. Yes, over here, right here, the gentleman.
Watching this, I was reminded about the relationship Franklin had with his mother, and that's something, you know, that I've seen before, but I don't know anything about his father. And and who he was and what he did. Is that in the film at all? Curious.
Yes, it is. Yes.
Well, his father was much older than his mother. And so it did refer in the film, he died when he was in college. And he was he was of the branch of the family that moved up to the Hudson Valley to be farmers. And that was the occupation that my grandfather considered his occupation, except when he dabbled in architecture. But he would sometimes sign Franklin Roosevelt Farmer. So that's what he did. Yeah, there has been, but the thing that made me sort of helped me to put it all together was to realize that you have the same expectations, you have the same pride and love and fascination for your grandparents and the family that has come before you. So my experience is really not any different than your experience. The difference comes in that everyone knows everything about my family, and maybe everyone doesn't know everything about your family. And so it feels a little more exposed. And that was hard to comprehend as a kid, especially I didn't quite know how to manage all that for some time. But thankfully, I'm older now.
One last question. Yes, right here.
I'm sure you've done quite a bit of research on the archival involved. Was that something that was new to you, or anything that was surprising to you?
Well, I wouldn't say there was anything that was surprising, but some of the photographs I hadn't seen, and so they're really wonderful to. It is just such a visual experience, and to think that these are photographs. These aren't actors. These are the real people, and that's really what it looked like, and what it, you know, you can tell the story just from the picture, and so that was really just such a great thing.
And I just wanted to say one thing about the photographs, in that as you saw, there were some of Eleanor and Franklin when they were young. We have some of them when they're children and all. And the quality of those is not that great, but they are the most treasured gifts to have that record. And then, of course, you have some absolutely pristine, I mean, Dan was able to work from glass plate negatives that we'd gotten down in Warm Springs, Georgia, to do some, you know, prints of those photographs. So the quality, sometimes it's, the content trumps quality. And so, for example, their oldest daughter, Anna, she had a Brownie camera that she took on the road when her father was running for the state senate in New York in 1910. This is my facts, yeah. And they are muzzy, and you know, something, you know, all, and they are treasures. I mean, there's parts in the story where they talk about him, you know, being with the, you know, all these ladies on the road, you know, who are just loving to see this handsome young politician, and he's got his arm around these three ladies, and then all these comments that Eleanor had, and they're just perfect. I mean, they go perfectly with the script. So the unfortunate thing is, as many photographs as we take nowadays, so many of them are electronic, so please make some prints, especially you young guys, because, you know, they're going to disappear. And it's just a treasure to find those old family photographs.
I will debate with Pam a little bit. And we've debated about this a bit. Quality definitely helps content. So,
sharpen them up, right?
That's right. That's what we have Photoshop for.
No.
Well, I'd like to thank Anne and Pam and Dan for coming and being with us this evening. If you haven't been to Hyde Park or Warm Springs or Campobello, which I've had the good fortune, after you've seen this documentary series, you definitely want to go, because there's some, we're blessed here in the U.S. to have that, and of course Campobello is so close, it's you really should take advantage of that. And again, our thanks to the New Hampshire Institute of Politics, and a reminder that you can watch it on NHP TV. We are now, if you watch us on Comcast, we are Channel 2 and Channel 802. And we'll be repeating it again at 10 o'clock as well, right? So if you miss the 8 o'clock show, you can watch it at 10. So thank you for coming, and have a safe trip home.